Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Survive in Ancient Greece by Robert Garland, narrated by Liam Gerrard. Introduction. How to Survive in Ancient Greece is not a history book in the conventional sense of the word. It's asking you to imagine that you suddenly find yourself transported back in time and place and discover a landscape for which you are completely unprepared. What do you need to know in order to survive? What will look vaguely familiar? What will seem radically different? What kind of people will you encounter? How will you expect them to interact with you, and you with them? What work will be available? How will you relax? What will you do if you become sick? How will you fit in? Can you fit in? That last decision, of course, is yours and yours alone. History, at its best, is always about imagining a past world. This book invites you to take an active role in bringing to life the world of ancient Greece and placing yourself squarely within it. The world you are going to enter is that of late 5th century Athens. I've chosen this period because it was one of the greatest moments of human achievement and is very well documented. The year is 420 BCE, when Athens and Sparta are enjoying an uneasy peace. At the time you arrive in Athens, manpower is getting back up to strength after a devastating plague. She rules a maritime empire that dominates the eastern Mediterranean. She has invested more faith in the judgment of the common man than any society before or since. Sophocles and Euripides are writing tragedies that will stir and provoke audiences 2,400 years later. Medical science is advancing. Socrates is getting a lot of people's backs up by telling them they need to rid themselves of all their unexamined opinions. And the Parthenon, the greatest Greek temple ever built, crowns the Acropolis. In short, human excellence has reached a peak. You might not want to stay too long, however, for 5 years later, Athens will take a decision that will set her on a downward spiral, ultimately leading to her total defeat at the hands of Sparta and her allies. Since this isn't a conventional history book, I've taken one or two liberties with time in the interests of, well, interest. For instance, I've commandeered Aristotle as an occasional witness, even though he was born a generation later, both because I thought you'd want to hear from him, and because what he says is representative of some widely held beliefs, not least regarding women. I've tried to provide as much information about what to expect when you arrive, irrespective of your gender and age. It's fair to say, however, that if you're a female, you're going to have to make a bigger adjustment to life in ancient Greece than you will if you're a male. Travelling back in time requires a big mental as well as physical adjustment, and I've done my best to prepare you for both. That's why I've included a number of interviews with Greeks from different walks of life and different places, hoping that these will help you to see the world from their perspective and further prepare you for what to expect. Things you should know. As an expat, you're going to be residing in classical Athens. Classical means the period from 490 to 323 BCE, from the Battle of Marathon, which the Athenians fight and win against the Persian invaders under King Xerxes, to the death of Alexander the Great, King of Macedon, by which time Athenian democracy had been sharply curtailed and Greek freedom has been virtually extinguished. What makes classical Athens so special? Most of our evidence about classical Greece comes from Athens, the city named after the goddess Athena. That's because the Athenians are both highly literate and very accomplished in all branches of artistic expression. This helps us to envisage how they lived in some detail. We know much less about how, say, the Spartans lived. They have left few archaeological traces and no writings that describe what life was like in Sparta. Most of what we know about them is preserved in the writings of non-Spartans, the foremost of whom, a biographer and moralist called Plutarch, lived in the Roman period hundreds of years after Sparta's eclipse. We know next to nothing about the daily lives of those who reside in other Greek polis, or city-states, about 1,000 in all, such as Corinth, Thebes, Syracuse, Mytilene, Miletus, and so forth, even though these polis were very important. A polis consists of both territory and an urban centre. It is self-governing and largely self-sufficient. There are also a number of peoples on the Greek mainland who occupy territories that do not possess an urban centre. How they conduct their affairs and their daily lives is a complete mystery. They have left behind no visible traces of their existence. Athens' surrounding landmass, known as Attica, is shaped like an elongated carrot and comprises some 1,000 square miles. It's about the size of Derbyshire, or Rhode Island, the smallest American state, if you happen to be American. Its urban centre is more like a medium-sized provincial town than a metropolis, in our understanding of the word. Farm animals are a common sight in built-up areas, as they are throughout the ancient world. Passageways between houses are narrow and winding. Most roads consist of beaten earth. They are dusty in the summer and muddy in the winter. The total population of Attica is about 150,000, half of whom live in Athens and the other half in the countryside. Approximately half of the population, too, are slaves and will remain so all their lives. This, therefore, is a very different kind of slavery from the one practiced by the Romans, who regularly grant freedom to slaves after they have performed several years of faithful and devoted service. Classical Athens is remarkable by any standards, having produced more men of genius per capita than any other place in history. Its contribution to Western civilization, in literature, art, history, architecture, philosophy, and many branches of science, including astronomy and medicine, is unparalleled. Athens reaches its peak in the mid to late 430s, when new temples are rising on the Acropolis following the Persian conflagration and before the disastrous Peloponnesian War breaks out in 431. However, it briefly recovers 15 years later, just before dispatching the doomed expedition to conquer Sicily. What you should know about Athenian history. It's essential for you to know a bit about the two major events that happen in the 5th century so that you can converse knowledgeably with the Athenians you encounter. The first is the Greco-Persian Wars. The Persians expected to win that battle and obliterate Athens from the face of the earth. They had a grudge against the city because it had given military assistance to the Greeks living in Ionia, modern-day Western Turkey, who were rebelling against their empire. But they were defeated by a much smaller Athenian army. Marathon was like the Battle of Britain. It totally gripped the Athenian imagination, and still does. The Persians returned 10 years later with a vast army led by King Xerxes. This time around they had it in mind to conquer the whole of Greece. They got as far as Athens, which they burned to the ground, but they were defeated at sea, and later on land. Before the naval battle, the Athenians had evacuated their civilian population to the island of Salamis, barely a mile from the coast of Attica. Since the battle took place in the Straits, the refugees had a front-row view of the conflict. It must have been an agonising moment. Had the Persians won, they would have landed on Salamis, killed all the men, and enslaved the women and children. I should point out that this treatment of the defeated was not uncommon in the ancient world, and though it was certainly barbaric, it was by no means exclusively barbarian. As you would expect, the Athenians hate the Persians for destroying their city, but don't assume that they hate them for being Persians. Though Greeks generally look down on non-Greeks and assume that their culture is superior, there's no convincing evidence that they're infected by our colour-based racism. You may meet Athenians who are good friends with Persians. After the Persians had withdrawn from the Greek mainland, the Athenians became head of the Delian League, a maritime confederacy of about 150 Greek states, so named because its headquarters were on the island of Delos in the centre of the Cyclades. The name Cyclades means the circling islands, because they roughly form a circle. By the middle of the 5th century, following attempts by some states to secede, the Delian League had become an instrument of Athenian imperialism. Membership was no longer optional. It was forbidden to secede, and most of the so-called allies were required to pay an annual tribute, though a few privileged members contributed ships. The other really big event is the Peloponnesian War, which was fought between Athens and Sparta and their respective allies. It broke out in 431 and will come to an end in 404, with a cessation in hostilities from 421 to 413. The Athenian historian Thucydides, who is writing a history of the war, comments that no campaign in history was more calamitous for the defeated than Athens' invasion of Sicily, which occurs during this interval. The naval expedition sets out with high hopes in 415 and suffers total defeat 2 years later. Out of many who left, few returned home. Thucydides tersely reports, a characteristically Greek understatement. It is well worth reading Thucydides' history before you travel back to ancient Greece. He's the father of political science. Immediately after their defeat in Sicily, the Athenians find themselves fighting for their lives. The city holds out, against all odds, for nearly 10 years, but is ultimately starved into submission. Its walls are destroyed, and it is deprived of all but 12 ships. Though its glory days are over, it is not, however, destroyed. The Peloponnesian War will prove a watershed in Greek history. Though Athens will recover remarkably quickly after the defeat, and even head a new alliance, the city will never be the same again. There is an irony to this, which is that her democratic institutions will become more effective in response to the mistakes that she made in the conduct of the Peloponnesian War. The Spartans are the polar opposite of the Athenians. Whereas the Athenians are innovative, outward-going, enterprising, and cosmopolitan, the Spartans are inward-looking, conservative, unadventurous, and mistrustful of foreigners. The two societies perfectly exemplify the difference between what the French anthropologist Claude Lévi-Strauss identified as hot and cold societies. Athens being virtually at boiling point, and Sparta being freezing cold. Sparta's conservatism is not a modern mirage. The inability to change and adapt will lead to her gradual demise in the 4th century, just as Athens' risk-taking mentality will lead to a more sudden downfall. It's regrettable the two sides never learn from each other. We rarely have the humility to learn from our enemies. What Athens looks like. Athens is a walled city, pierced with numerous gates. The wall in question was built at the instigation of the politician and general Themistocles, following the departure of the Persian invaders in 480. It utilizes the remains of the temples, statues, and grave monuments that the Persians destroyed after the Athenians had evacuated the city. Athens is also protected by the so-called Long Walls, some 200 meters apart, which join it to its coastal city called the Piraeus, which is the second largest city in Attica. At the time you arrive, the Piraeus is the foremost trading port in the classical world and the home of Athens' formidable fleet. It possesses 3 harbours, the largest of which, known as the Goblet, because of its shape, also handles exports and imports. The Greeks take enormous pride in their public buildings, and this is especially true of the Athenians. This point is strikingly demonstrated by the spectacular temples that adorn the city, particularly those on the Acropolis. Acropolis means literally high part of the city. It denotes the imposing rock with an artificially levelled platform, roughly rectangular in shape, which still dominates the skyline of the Greek capital today. Of these temples, none is more eye-catching than the Parthenon, meaning the Temple of the Maiden. The maiden in question being Athens' foremost deity, Athena. The Parthenon is a stunning testimony to Athens' unique standing in the Greek-speaking world, as both cultural leader and imperial powerhouse. Housed within it is a gigantic, resplendent image of the goddess, 12 meters high and covered in gold and silver over a sculpted wooden core. Other spectacular buildings adorn the Acropolis, including a monumental entrance gateway known as the Propylaea. In stark contrast to this public magnificence, there are few signs of private wealth, even though some Athenians, as in any society, are very wealthy. But even the wealthy live frugally by modern standards. The visitor will therefore be struck by the rundown appearance of private dwellings, compared with the opulence and scale of the public buildings. What compensates for this disparity is the sense of civic pride, which is unlike anything that we understand or are capable of emulating today. When the Athenians experience a financial windfall in 483, as a result of the discovery of a rich vein of silver at Laurium in South Attica, they use it to construct a fleet, instead of giving themselves a general handout or a tax cut, as we might do today. Later, they spend the surplus of the tribute that the allies pay to their coffers to rebuild what the Persians destroyed on the Acropolis. What life is like in the city? The centre of any polis is an open space known as the agora, which constitutes the civic, legal, and commercial heart of the community. The Athenian agora, capital A in this one case, lies to the north of the Acropolis. Males have to be at least 18 to enter. Women are discouraged from entering unless they are retailers. The most common type of building in any agora is the stoa, a structure with a colonnaded front, which provides shelter from the sun in the summer and from the wind, rain, and occasional snow in winter. It is here that men make business deals. For that reason, bankers set up their tables inside stoas. The word for bank, in both ancient and modern Greek, is trapeza, meaning table. The agora also houses the law courts. Cases are held in the open in several designated areas. The juries are very large, some as large as 601, the intention being to prevent bribery. The Athenians are very litigious, and their courts sit for about 200 days a year, virtually all the days when they aren't celebrating state-funded festivals. On the west side of the agora is a row of life-size bronze statues standing on a plinth. These represent the 10 eponymous heroes, who gave their names to the 10 Athenian tribes into which the citizen body is divided. Attached to the plinth is a notice board where all public business is announced. Close by is a circular building known as the tholos, where 50 members of the council of 500 from one of the 10 tribes are fed at public expense while they deliberate. 17 of these 50 members might spend the night in the tholos, so that they are on hand 24/7 to deal with any emergency that might arise. It is the duty of the council to prepare the agenda for meetings of the assembly. The council also debates all the issues in advance of each meeting in order to determine which of them will carry their recommendation. There are many other civic buildings in the Athenian agora, as well as a number of temples and religious structures. On the hill on the west side of the agora is the temple of Hephaestus, located in a district where metal workers ply their trade under the patronage of their god. The agora is the commercial centre of Athens, attracting merchants from all over the Aegean. At dawn, retailers set up temporary stalls where agricultural products and manufactured goods can be purchased. Finally, an agora is a place to chat and exchange gossip, as suggested by the verb agorazein, which, among other meanings, approximates to loaf about in the agora. Groups with similar interests or backgrounds, as well as foreigners hailing from the same city, have their favourite meeting places. Philosophers, such as the Stoics, whose name derives from the painted stoa in which they gather daily, will gather here about 150 years later to debate the nature of virtue and other topics. How the city is run. The citizen body consists of between 30,000 to 50,000 freeborn males, whose parents are both freeborn Athenian. They are known as the demos, which means the people. The people enjoy absolute power, because Athens is a radical or direct democracy. There is no government and no opposition, no political parties, no prime minister or president, and no elections. Every important decision pertaining to the state is decided by a vote of the people in the assembly. In other words, every vote is a referendum. All citizens enjoy equality before the law, and, if charged with any crime, they are judged by a jury of their peers. Service in the military is required of all citizens. The cavalry plays a very limited role in Greek warfare, owing to the unevenness of the terrain. Those who can afford to purchase a suit of armour, helmet, greaves, breastplate, sword and spear, serve as heavily armed infantry, known as hoplites. The word hoplite comes from the Greek word hoplon, the large round shield carried by a hoplite, which is his most distinctive piece of equipment. Those unable to afford a suit of armour are required to serve as rowers in the fleet. All citizens are called upon to serve on a rotating basis, the military being divided into the 10 tribes that are used for all administrative purposes. In Sparta, by contrast, Athens' bugbear, the citizen body is perpetually under arms. As indicated, Athens is a very open city that welcomes foreigners, both as visitors and as residents. It hosts perhaps as many as 20,000 so-called metics, foreigners who reside within its borders. This makes it unique in the Greek-speaking world. Most metics live in the Piraeus and are engaged in trade. The vast majority are citizens of other Greek polis, but a few are non-Greeks, including Phoenicians and Egyptians. Their talents contribute significantly to the vitality of Athenian culture, and many have become very prosperous. As a sign of their importance and inclusion, they are permitted to participate in the Panathenaia, Athens' premier festival. In time of war, they serve in the army or navy, but they are also free to leave Athens and return to their homelands if they choose. How religion works. The Greeks are polytheists. Zeus, the so-called father of gods and men, who wields the lightning bolt, is the most powerful, but he's anything but omnipotent, since his fellow Olympian deities, who constitute a fractious and highly dysfunctional family, also exercise considerable power. The Olympians are so named because they live on Mount Olympus in the Pindus range in northern Greece. Mountaineering is not a sport in the ancient world, so no Greek has ever climbed to the summit of Mount Olympus to discover that there are no gods living up on top. The majority of gods who are worshipped throughout the Greek-speaking world are variants of the Olympian deities and were already known to Homer. They include Zeus, god of oaths and hospitality, Hera, goddess of marriage, Poseidon, god of the sea, Hades, god of the underworld, Athena, goddess of female arts and war, Ares, god of war, Hermes, messenger of the gods and god of commerce, Demeter, goddess of the corn and the harvest, Dionysus, god of wine and the theatre, Aphrodite, goddess of love and beauty, Artemis, goddess of hunting and protector of wild beasts, Apollo, god of music, healing and prophecy, and Hephaestus, lame god of metalworking. Each of these gods has other areas under her or his control, but these are their main responsibilities. In addition, they all have second names, so to speak, depending on where they are worshipped or which characteristic is being attributed to them. On the Athenian Acropolis alone, four separate Athenas are worshipped: Athena Parthenos, maiden; Athena Polias, of the city; Athena Promachos, she who fights in the front rank; and Athena Hygeia, health. The Athenians don't have exclusive entitlement to Athena's goodwill, however. For instance, the Spartans venerate Athena Polyakos, guardian of the city, as one of their foremost deities, along with variations of all the other Olympian deities. When Greeks go to war, therefore, both sides regularly evoke the same gods, albeit by a different cult title. Observance is conducted in the open around an altar. Temples merely house the cult statue and offerings to the gods. The Parthenon has been aptly likened to an ornate jewellery box, its primary function being to give pleasure to Athena and to provide her with a residence when she visits the city. The gods are anthropomorphic, that is, they resemble human beings both physically and in their psychological makeup. This is why they take pleasure in the smell of the roasting animals that are sacrificed in their honour. They also enjoy watching humans displaying their prowess at athletic, equestrian, and musical contests, and for this reason, these events are regularly incorporated into their festivals. The priesthood is not a vocation, and priests are not in the business of offering spiritual assistance or counsel to worshippers. Be warned, there are no therapists in ancient Greece. The main function of priests and priestesses is to oversee the sanctuary under their control and to supervise the observances that are conducted within it. They are not expected to set an example, moral or otherwise, in large part because Greek religion does not promote morality. Piety towards the gods and the dead, not good behaviour, is its central aim. The Greeks invoke their gods to do harm to their enemies just as frequently as they invoke them to give benefits to themselves or their family. Priests serve gods and priestesses serve goddesses. Some priesthoods are open to every citizen, depending only on gender. Others are hereditary in specific kin groups, and still others are open to anyone who pays the requisite fee for the privilege. Most priests hold office for only a year, but some serve for life. In Athens, the most important priesthood is that of Athena Polias, of the city. Her priestess is appointed from the ranks of one of Athens' most venerable kin groups, the Etiobutidae. She has no political influence, however, because, as a woman, she cannot attend the assembly. So far as we know, priests never constituted a political lobby or interest group. In fact, the opposite is likely to have been the case, since they have to compete with one another for state funding. The Etiobutidae also supply the priest of the second most important cult in Athens, that of Poseidon Erectus. Erectus is the name of an early king of Athens, whose name became attached to Poseidon only in relation to this one cult. The worship of the Olympians is only one aspect of Greek religion, however. Another important group are the chthonic deities, whose name derives from chthon, meaning earth, since they live underground. We know much less about chthonic deities than we do about the Olympians, because temples are not built in their honour, and festivals are not celebrated in their name. But though they do not command the same resources as the Olympians, they are still very powerful. The best place to become acquainted with their modus operandi is in the final play of Aeschylus' trilogy, Oresteia, which is entitled Eumenides, or Kindly Ones, a euphemism for a particularly vengeful group of chthonic deities known as the Furies. As soon as Orestes murders his mother to avenge his father, the Furies pursue him relentlessly. Aeschylus suggests they are vile and repellent women, with snakes in their hair and rasping breath. At the end of the play, however, they are transformed into the Kindly Ones, the title of the play, and offered an honoured place in the state with a cult on the north flank of the Acropolis. A third important aspect of Greek religion is hero worship. The word hero in this context means something very different from its English usage. It refers to a person whose life has been exceptional, whether for good or ill. The most celebrated hero is Heracles, Roman name Hercules, who, among his 12 labours, slew the Nemean lion. To demonstrate his descent from Heracles, Alexander the Great is depicted on coins wearing the lionskin. Another famous hero is Oedipus, who unknowingly killed his father and married his mother. His life is a testimony to the terrible consequences of mistaken identity and of the frightening power of coincidence. Heroes are powerful in the vicinity of their graves and can be summoned to help the city-state in which their bones reside in times of crisis. The way to restore their vitality and enlist their support is by offering them a blood sacrifice at their graves. The blood restores their vigour. I've talked about the gods at some length because you're going to have to deal with them a lot. You'll probably arrive by sea, not least because the Greeks are a seafaring nation. I don't want to alarm you, but make sure you sacrifice to Poseidon before boarding. Homer's Odyssey constantly emphasises the dangerous hazards of the deep, since weather conditions in the Aegean Sea are highly unpredictable, and storms often arise without warning. The implacable enmity of Poseidon to Odysseus is therefore based on a frightening reality. Ostensibly, that enmity is caused by Odysseus' blinding of Poseidon's one-eyed son, the giant Polyphemus, but all Greek mariners know that the sea god is to be greatly feared. What the family means in ancient Greece? The Greeks, who proverbially have a word for everything, do not have a word for family. The nearest equivalent is oikos or oikia, more accurately translated as household. Both words refer equally to a group of people living under the same roof and to the property that their household owns, namely the house and its outbuildings, the land upon which it stands, and all its household effects, including slaves. In short, the oikos is both people and property. Husbands are typically at least 10 years older than their wives. Many girls marry at the onset of puberty or shortly afterwards, the belief being that this will maximise their child-rearing capacity. In reality, this practice has the very opposite effect, since many young girls are biologically ill-equipped to give birth shortly after puberty and become permanently damaged as a result. The frequency with which they become pregnant further...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.